This is really impressive. As a scientist, you hardly ever get to see the people that you try and do something for. So this is really, really impressive. So I really thank you for coming, and I hope we can give you some more insight to what we do. So what Lee was talking about is as a systems approach, it really takes a village of people to actually bring things together. And so I'm just one of the little people in that village, and Lee, you know, controls a lot of that village. So when you work with a living legend like that, you really have to think bold, because if you don't think bold, he won't think much of you. So some of the things that we do is really attack the problem holistically and try and find out all of the components of what the Borrelia bacteria is. And so Borrelia is the bacteria that causes a Lyme disease, and to really understand that problem, you need to be able to break that down into all its components. And so that's what we do. We break it down first. That's really a systems approach to try and understand each of the parts before you can build into something that you can use. So my group is a protein group. And so I think, I won't bore you here, but I think most of you all know what a protein is. I think everyone knows what DNA is, right? Everyone understands what the human genome is, I've heard about all that. But how much of the proteins do you really know? So if I have an example, so of the human, of us, how many proteins do you think there are? 10,000? 20,000? 30,000? 40,000? Anyone want to guess? Hands up for 50,000? 500,000? Actually, no, there's only 20,000. Do you know plants actually have twice as many as what we do? So it's actually interesting. So Borrelia is actually a small organism, and it only contains 1,300 proteins. But to get to those, we really need to understand the organism. So we've entered into a number of different collaborations where we've collected the most infectious Borrelia that's in the US. So we actually grow, so to know the problem, to attack the problem, we've got to know thy enemy. And so we grow the bacteria upstairs. We have the strains that infect 50% of the Northeast. We're collecting 27 other strains throughout the southern part of the US, and also more strains from the Northeast as well. And so with that, we can take that material, break it down to all those individual proteins, and then build that database that Lee was talking about. So what do we do with that? Once we have that, we can understand each of the molecular forms that we have, even though we have a genome sequence, and this is something that we've just published with Lee's group, and some of the fantastic work that we all do, we all lend off each other. So Lee's group does a lot of the genome sequencing, we do some proteins, and we feed off each other. We inform some of the DNA work, and the DNA work informs some of the protein work. But once we do that, we can do what we call a quantitative approach. And so what we want to do is actually find out what's the most abundant proteins of the Borrelia. Why do we want to do that? Well, the reason is, if you're infected with Borrelia at some stage, at one point, that Borrelia has to die. It doesn't live on forever. It'll divide, it'll grow into some other ones, but the parent will die. What happens to that parent? Does it just dissolve? No. The body, as Neha was telling you about, has an immune response. It tries to break those things down into small little components that are no longer infective. But those components still circulate around the body. Eventually they get rid of. The excretory system gets rid of them. You just go to bed and they'll be gone by the time you get in the morning. But those pieces of material from the Borrelia can be a diagnostic. Do you know that to this day, there is still not a diagnostic that tells you that you've actually been infected by the Borrelia? The diagnostic really is your immune response. And so that's a very powerful response. You can detect antibodies if you've been exposed to it, but that comes several months down the track. There's an immediate response, then the long-lasting response takes 2 to 3 months to get hold of. In that time, people that may not have immediate responses may not go detected at all. And so you could get on later in your life and start to get more and more effects. So our goal here is to take those components that we know of, the most highly abundant components of the bacteria, work out how to make an assay to those, and then we can look for those in the blood and in the urine of patients that may have been infected with the Borrelia. At that point, we can tell you specifically that you have Borrelia in your body, and then we have to do something about that. That's the goal of a lot of the stuff that we do here, is to create these assays and try and work out blood responses. The other component is, once we work out what Lee was talking about, is vaccines, we can also understand which are the most invariant proteins of the Borrelia. There has been a vaccine that was made some 15, 20 years ago. It was pulled off the market by the anti-vaccine lobby. It's coming back at the moment in Europe, but it's still built on a protein that's hypervariable. And we know that from all the different strains that we're looking at. So you may have a vaccine to one strain, but if you go somewhere else and you get another strain of that bacteria, you'll no longer protect it. So the things that we're trying to do is, by having this knowledge database, is to work out which component is the most invariant component, what's the most highly antigenic component, and those are the things that we can say that here is a good vaccine target. So that most of the things that we do here is trying to understand the bacteria at its molecular level. So with that, I just want to thank you for all coming, and if you have any questions, I can answer them at any point. Thank you.